Good morning, everybody. I hope that you're doing well, you and your families, and I hope that you've been able to keep up with our videos that we've been posting and even some of the things that I've been asking you to interact with. And so here we are this morning in our teen Sunday school class, and we've been studying through the life of Christ, and now we are up to the point where Jesus starts introducing this idea of discipleship. You know, there are a lot of terms that we use to describe Christianity, and some of those terms can be confusing. I have to remind myself at times, you know, I was saved at a very early age, and I was brought up in the church, and so sometimes those terms just make sense to me. I'll even call it sometimes Christianese, and so I'll even say some terms that I know. But I have to remember that to some people, those terms are confusing and they don't know exactly what we're talking about. And disciple can actually be one of those terms. We don't use that word very much in our ordinary speech, but it really is a good way to describe those who follow Jesus. The word disciple, actually, it originally meant one who learns. And it comes from the same root word as discipline. Okay, so a disciple, we could say, is a saved person who follows Jesus to learn how to live a life that is pleasing to God. All right, I'll say that again. Disciple is a saved person who follows Jesus to learn how to live a life that is pleasing to God. There is a very important distinction involved. Okay, you do not follow Jesus or learn about Jesus to be saved. Salvation always comes first. So when you trust Jesus as your personal Savior, it's then at that point that you begin your life as a Christian and you start a life of Christian service and learning. So here's the deal. If we are going to be disciples of Jesus, what then are we supposed to do, right? There are many vague references made to following the Lord and serving Christ, but often we don't hear specifics. And so in this lesson here this morning, we are introduced to the attitudes and actions that disciples of Jesus are actually asked to take. And like most of Jesus' teaching, these deal with our hearts and our attitudes as much as our outside behavior. So when our hearts and attitudes are right, our attitudes are correct, then right behavior will follow. And so as Jesus went about his personal ministry, he often attracted large crowds. We talked several weeks ago about some of Jesus' miracles and the fact that he drew large crowds. And people came for many different reasons. Some people came to hear Jesus preach. He was the greatest preacher of all time. And so that was a draw for many people. Some came because they wanted to see the miracles that he performed. Some even came because they wanted to be healed. Some came or some followed him constantly. And so they were listening and watching for an occasion to accuse him of doing wrong. Some came because they wanted to learn more about him. And so Jesus spoke to this crowd and he told them something about being a true disciple. He spoke about the attitude that a disciple should have and the cost a disciple should be willing to pay for following Jesus Christ. So I would invite you to take your Bibles and turn to Luke chapter 14. Luke chapter 14, we're going to pick up in verse 25, okay, and see if you can start to think about or see some of these requirements for a disciple, okay? Luke chapter 14, verse 25 says, "Now great multitudes went with him, and he turned and said to them, 'If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sister, yes, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. And whoever does not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not sit down first and count the cost, whether he has enough to finish it. Lest after he has laid the foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, "This man began to build and was not able to finish." Or what king, going to make war against some another king, does not sit down first and consider whether he is able with 10,000 to meet him who comes against him with 20,000? Or else, while the other is still a great way off, he sends a delegation and asks conditions of peace. So likewise, whoever of you does not forsake all that he has cannot be my disciple. Salt is good, but if the salt has lost its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is neither fit for the land nor for the dunghill, but men throw it out. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. So Jesus gave two requirements in this that I see for being a disciple. Of course, before anybody can be a disciple, they have to be saved. After personal salvation, there are some adjustments in our attitudes that must be made if we are to follow Jesus. The first adjustment in our attitude toward other things, or is toward other things and other people. We read the word hate in these verses, and that naturally evokes some strong feelings with us when we hear that word, right? Is Jesus telling us to hate our parents or our families? In the way that we would ordinarily use the word today, no. Okay? What Jesus is saying is that we must put him first in our lives. This is a matter of choice, and it's a matter of priority. Now, I know you hear me say that a lot, priorities, but here it is in being a disciple of Jesus. If we are going to be a disciple of Jesus, a true disciple of Jesus, then we must put Jesus ahead of everything else. This includes our families and includes our own lives. Okay? We can actually understand that brave, dedicated men and women have often risked their own lives for some cause. We think about soldiers. They risk their lives for our freedoms. We should understand that Jesus requires a disciple to choose him and to choose his service above even the closest of family ties. Now, don't get me wrong. This doesn't mean that you have to love your family less. It just means that you have to love Jesus even more. So that's the first requirement. The second requirement is the willingness to bear a cross and follow where Jesus leads. This is a strange statement to those who first heard it. You know, the cross was a symbol of a horrible death. The Romans used the cross to punish the absolute worst criminals in the land. And those who were condemned to death were actually forced to carry their cross to the place of execution. And this is the figure that Jesus used to indicate the level of commitment necessary to be a disciple. It simply means that we must be willing to sacrifice everything should it become necessary in order to follow Jesus. Now let's think about what all that includes, okay? This would include our reputation. It would include the applause of others. Cross-bearing is not enduring the ordinary troubles of life. Instead, it involves those special hardships that come about simply because we have chosen to follow Christ. Notice that a disciple has to follow Jesus. This simply means that we are to go where he goes. All right, so let's think back a few lessons. Jesus went to John to be baptized. All right, so we can conclude from that a disciple of Jesus would follow him in baptism. That's the first step. As we moved on through Jesus' life, we saw that he went to the synagogue every Sabbath day. A disciple of Jesus will worship faithfully in a New Testament church. Jesus went about doing good. A disciple of Jesus will be constantly aware of situations where they can show the nature and character of Jesus by helping others. Now, there are a lot of other illustrations that I could give, but why would anyone want to be called a disciple of Jesus if they did not want to be like Jesus? And so he moves through this passage and he brings up the idea, okay, these are the requirements of a disciple, but you also need to count the cost. You see, there are strict requirements for discipleship. And Jesus did not suggest that we enter into the business of being a disciple without some very careful thought, some consideration. And so he used two illustrations that were common in his day to show us how important it is to take a look at the whole of our lives. So first he uses an illustration about building a tower. And the first thing you would do in any building project is to see how much it's going to cost to complete the project and whether or not your resources are adequate enough to actually finish the job. And if you don't take that into consideration, here's what happens. You exhaust all your resources, you run out of money, you run out of materials before the job gets completely finished. And so now you're left over with this halfway built tower in the case of Jesus' illustration. And he points out that if you do that, you've run out of everything, now you have half a tower there, then you are going to be mocked because of your lack of judgment. And this illustrates the person who has an outburst of zeal to follow Jesus. They are pumped about it. They're excited right off the bat after they get saved. But here's what they didn't do. They did not realize that being a disciple is a lifelong and a life-changing business. And so they run out of that zeal, or that fire burns out. Being a disciple of Jesus, let me tell you, is the best and greatest way to live. But it's also an expensive way to live. It might cost us friends along the way. It may even cost us some family. It's most certainly going to take us down an unpopular path. And so Jesus was not suggesting that we should not be his disciples, but he was suggesting that we go into it with our eyes open. He uses a second illustration here about a king who is going into a fight, going into a war, actually. And in this illustration, this king had 10,000 men, but the enemy actually had 20,000 men. And so he points out, in such a situation, a wise king is going to go out and he's going to send some delegates to seek peace, and he's going to do what he can to avoid the war. And he does that because he should know that he could not possibly win. So he should take action that was in the best interest of his kingdom and his army. And again, what this is suggesting to us is that we should be wise and prudent in our choices. I think the overall theme through this is God always wants us to make informed choices. Only Satan would have us choose without considering the consequences. And so the key in both these cases is total and complete commitment and dedication. So the bottom line is, if we are going to truly follow Jesus, we must be willing to totally commit ourselves to the effort. And yes, it may cost. It may cost us. But finish what you start and fight with all that is in you. You see, Jesus doesn't have any part-time disciples. We are either with him or we're not. And so he kind of closes out this passage with this idea of salt that isn't salty. And that's kind of a funny thing to think about, because you want salt because it makes things salty. But in this illustration, if we want to be disciples of Jesus, we have to forsake all other pursuits and put his service first. This is easy to say. It sounds easy as I say it, but it is often difficult to do. So what if we don't forsake all? What if we start to follow Jesus, but we get sidetracked? Jesus dealt with this in the illustration about the salt that wasn't salty anymore. This illustrates what happens when someone begins to follow Jesus without the right attitude of love and total respect for him. It illustrates what happens when a decision is made without first considering what the cost might be. This pictures the man who starts out right but has a wrong attitude. He starts out as salt. Salt is good and it is necessary to life. Okay, salt isn't exactly food, but it does make our food taste better. And so we need some salt to live. But here's the thing, salt, like many other things, can spoil, mainly by having other substances added to it. And then at that point, it loses its saltiness and it becomes good for nothing, and the idea is it's thrown away. And so Jesus was saying that those who begin to follow him but do not have a changed heart and are not willing to make the sacrifices necessary will not finish their course. And so like salt, so many things will be added into their lives and they won't be salty anymore. Then they will not be useful to God or to men. Now, this isn't the inevitable result, because we can have the right attitude, we can be willing to pay the cost, and we can be the salt of the earth. So let's try to kind of rein all of this in, pull it into perspective, right? If being a disciple is so demanding, well, then why would anyone want to be one? And maybe you're thinking that, Pastor Josh, everything you've just said, that sounds like that is very demanding on me. And so why would I want to be a disciple of Jesus? Well, the reason is very simple. It's because the rewards are great. Only in being a disciple of Jesus can we have a true understanding of life, death, and eternity. So if we look at life without Christ, we will only see hopelessness. But if we look, if we decide to follow the Lord, if we decide to be his disciple, we will see a future as bright as the promises of God. And I want you to remember this, that all of us are going to die one day. And all of us are going to give an account to the things that we have done in life. And so when we stand before Jesus at the judgment seat of Christ, the most important things we have done are going to involve our discipleship. You see, following Jesus is not an impossible burden. Jesus actually said this in Matthew 11, 29 and 30. He says, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." The greatest way for anyone to live is to be born again Christian and to faithfully serve the Lord in a New Testament church. Now, as I've said, there may be some sacrifices that we have to make in order to do that. And there will certainly be some attitude adjustments along the way. And there's going to be some very difficult choices to make. But the rewards are great. And the burden of all of this, it truly is light. Never forget that we have Jesus to help us when we follow him. So hopefully I've got you thinking, okay, how can I become a disciple of Jesus? Well, I said earlier, first, you have to be saved. That is, you have to have a personal faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior. And then you have to resolve in your heart that you will put doing the will of God first in your life. This involves an attitude, and it involves many choices. If you follow the Lord, you will submit to baptism through a New Testament church. You will then worship God regularly in that church. You will pray for God to open doors of opportunity for you to serve him. You will read your Bible and you will learn all that you can about Jesus. Remember, a disciple is really a learner. You will be a witness for Jesus wherever you have an opportunity. And let me tell you, there are going to be many other ways that God might lead you to serve him. But the main thing is that you will no longer be trying to do what you want to do. You're going to make it your best effort to do what Jesus wants you to do. This is the essential and key element in being a disciple of Jesus Christ. If we want to be disciples, we must make a choice that the will of God comes first, before anything else in our lives, no matter whom it involves and no matter what it costs. You know, discipleship may not seem like an easy choice to make, because a lot of times we tend to view our lives as, hey, this is my time. And this is my life. I'm going to do with it what I want to do. I say a lot of times, you know, we have that Burger King mentality. We want to have it our way. And so we get this mentality, well, I want to have things my way. And so we think that we can do what we want in our lives. But let me tell you, that is very seldom true. We are not our own. The Bible makes it very clear that we are bought with a price. And we are here because many sacrifices have been made for us. The greatest of all was the death of Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary. Jesus was looking ahead to the cross when he required his disciples to be cross bearers. That's why he used that illustration. And so here's my challenge to you. I want you to take a look at your life. Where do you want to be in 5 years? Maybe 10 years, 20 years, 40 years? Okay? How about eternity? You see, you and I will be somewhere in eternity. If we make the right choices today, we will all be in heaven, a place of great blessing. And so the best choice, the best place to start, the only place to start, is to trust and follow Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. And then make the decision to follow him in baptism in a local New Testament church. And then deciding to worship in that local church. And reading your Bible and learning all you can about Jesus. And finding ways that you can serve him. And that is how you can be a disciple of Jesus Christ. Next week, Lord willing, we're going to continue through the life of Christ, and we're going to look at Jesus and his response to the children. But today, my challenge is for you to really consider this thought of being a true disciple of Jesus. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for everything that you have given to us. Father, help us to make the conscious decision to be your disciple. Father, in this time where basically everything else has been put on hold, we can make some very wise decisions to put you back as number one in our lives. Lord, if there's someone that is listening to this or watching that doesn't know you as their personal Savior, Father, I plead with you that you would place that burden on their heart and allow them to come to a saving knowledge of you. And then, Lord, allow them to take that first step and maybe come to a local church and be baptized and just start to follow Jesus in everything that they do with their lives. Father, I know that there will be many believers that are watching this as well. And Lord, I just ask that you would help them to reorganize their priorities in life. Right now, we're going through an awesome time of reset. And Lord, help us to realize that while everything else has been put off right now, we can still worship you. And I believe in many cases you probably have been put back into number one. But Lord, when everything gets opened back up again, help us to remember that if we are going to truly be your disciples, we need to keep you first. Father God, we thank you again for the opportunity we have to spread your word through this means. In Jesus' name, amen.